is synthetic braiding hair giving people cancer?
Our latest investigation found carcinogens in all 10 products of artificial braiding hair that we tested. This puts the health of people who wear synthetic braiding hair and the braiders who install them at risk.
I'm Michelle, chem PhD, and I talk about the science behind beauty products. I've been asked a lot about this Consumer Report story. Let's dig into it. First off, I think this is a really important area of research. Traditionally in science, the further we get from white and male, the less we know because there is simply less data. So I think it's great that Consumer Reports is doing research on products that a lot of black women use. But that also means that it is a bigger problem if the results aren't presented in an honest and transparent way. It will make the problem worse. Before, we didn't know if we should worry about bears or sharks, but new research shows that there is only one shark and it's actually a bit pathetic. But now people are spending all their energy building shark-proof nets and writing petitions to hire more lifeguards. Everyone has forgotten about the bears. In my opinion, that is exactly what's happening with these Consumer Reports results. Here's the headline. Dangerous chemicals were detected in 100% of the braiding hair we tested. They tested 10 of the most popular products and they detected carcinogens, which are cancer-causing chemicals, in all of them. Again, I think it's great that Consumer Reports did this testing. But if you've watched my videos before, you'll know the crucial thing that these headlines are missing, the quantity. How much of these chemicals were there? In toxicology, there's a saying, the dose makes the poison. If you have enough of anything, it can be harmful to your health. The flip side is, if you have a small enough amount of anything, it won't be very dangerous. We all have about 90 micrograms of uranium inside our bodies. And even though uranium is really harmful, that's still fine because there is such a low amount. So as we keep reading, we're looking for the amount. There's a whole bunch here about the background behind the research and then their top findings. They found carcinogens in 100% of the samples. They found lead in 9 out of 10 products, other VOCs including acetone in all the products. So we have numbers, but these are not the numbers that we actually want to know. Chemists are getting better and better at measuring things. There are probably more atoms in a pack of braiding hair than there are grains of sand on Earth, so it's not that surprising if at least a few of those atoms are lead, even in that 10th sample that supposedly has no lead. It's just that we don't have the technology to measure it yet. So these top findings are just super unhelpful, and to me, it is really weird that they picked these as their top findings. The next section tells us about their methods, and then we get to our first category of substances. They tell us all of the products they tested contain multiple carcinogens. They tell us about benzene and how bad it is. It's linked to leukemia. They're still not telling us about amounts. They have a PDF linked, which has the full test results. Let's go through it. So let's look at benzene. We've got 16, 15, 18, 18 micrograms per kilogram. So let's take the worst one. It looks like in a relatively long hairstyle, you might use about a pound, which is half a kilogram of hair. So we're looking at about 9 micrograms of benzene. Now, is this actually scary? I've talked about benzene before. It's an air pollution that we actually all breathe in every day. It's an additive in petrol, so it is pretty unavoidable. It's everywhere. But obviously not everyone gets leukemia despite breathing it in every day, and breathing it in is generally the main concern. It doesn't really go through skin easily. So it's not really something to worry about unless you get a lot of it. This is mostly occupational exposure, like if you're a mechanic or if you work at a petrol station. Now, if you live in a city, you're going to be breathing in around 60 micrograms a day, about 6 times, a bit over 6 times as much as the amount that's in the whole half kilo of hair. Now, you are probably not inhaling all of the hair unless things are really not going well for you. Most of the benzene would just be drifting off into the air away from you. And this sort of hairstyle usually lasts for weeks or even months, let's say 4 weeks. If we divide this, we get 0.32 micrograms per day on average. I'm gonna go do some scale drawings, like and subscribe for really high-tech graphics. This is 60 micrograms. This is how much you inhale every day. This is 9 micrograms. This is how much is in the complete half kilo of hair. This is how much extra benzene you might be inhaling every day if we take our half a kilo of hair and we spread that out over 4 weeks. So the difference between here and here is 187 times, almost 200 times difference. I also drew these two for comparison. So this is how much benzene you produce while cooking on a gas stove. Now, obviously not all of that benzene gets sucked into your lungs, but That's sort of similar to the hair situation. And this bottom one is how much benzene you actually breathe into your lungs as you're filling up your car for 5 minutes on average. So the difference between these big bars down the bottom and our little hair amount per day is about 300 times bigger. And these big bars are all everyday amounts of benzene that a lot of us who aren't going to end up with leukemia regularly breathe in. So do we really need to freak out that much about how scary this benzene is and all this stuff about leukemia? I posted about this on Instagram and some people asked me if braiders cleaning hair in hot water might be a concern. Let's say a braider boils 10 pounds of the worst hair for 10 minutes. This is a massive overestimate. In a perfectly sealed small bathroom every day for 78 years. They would have roughly an extra 2 in 100,000 chance of cancer. It is really difficult to seal a small space as well. Ventilation monitoring is kind of a hobby of mine. And if you're boiling water, it would just be super humid. I'm pretty sure people would think to open a window or turn on a fan. And there are other hazardous chemicals that would build up much faster under these conditions. The focus on benzene distracts from investigating those and also for pushing for safety measures aside from testing hair for benzene. I would be 100% behind a petition about ventilation that reduces the risk for anything dodgy in the air, but Consumer Reports is all about the shark. The other carcinogen that they actually name is methylene chloride. It is a solvent, it's in paint stripper. I used tons of the stuff when I was in the lab, obviously with safety precautions. It's not great for you, and I have seen these so-called burst gel nail removers that I'm pretty sure are just dichloromethane. I would definitely recommend avoiding those. But the amounts in hair, mostly under 20 micrograms per kilogram, there's one measurement that sticks out at 54. But the other measurement that they got for the same product is 19, which is a massive difference. So these numbers just don't look reliable. They should really work out what is actually going on and, you know, fix it. So if we have half a kilo of hair again, that means that we have 27 micrograms of our methylene chloride. One drop is over 66,000 micrograms, so the difference here is about 2,500. For comparison, the Australian Safe Work Guidelines, they allow 1.7 million micrograms to be inhaled per day. I am not saying that we should all go out and inhale this much every day just for fun, but we need to have perspective. This is over 60,000 times as much as there is in half a kilo of the worst hair product, and that is still considered relatively okay daily exposure. Then we have heavy metals, and they do actually talk about dose here. All 9 products could expose a regular user of any of these products to a level of lead that could be concerning over time. Is this actually true? Lead is bad, and they talk about some of the issues in the article. One of the reasons that I personally don't grow vegetables in my garden is lead. I live in a part of Sydney where there has been pretty high levels of lead measured, and you might want to look that up in your own area. This time, Consumer Reports do show the amounts as a percentage of MADL, which is the maximum allowable dose level. So what exactly is this? They explain that Consumer Reports scientists picked California's food limit as the point of comparison. They say they considered looking at inhalation, skin contact, or eating, and they ended up choosing eating. Their logic is braiders might accidentally eat hair because it breaks off. Small children might chew on their hair, which is fair enough. But how much are they saying you're eating to get these percentages? They don't say this, so I messed around with the numbers in the table. They worked out how much would be in 25 grams of hair, and then they compared it to the maximum allowable dose. I don't have synthetic hair, but this is 25 grams of acrylic yarn. This is a bit bigger than tennis ball sized, and this is a 13 gram ribbon. So they calculated this chart based on thinking that people might accidentally roughly eat this much hair or 2 of these ribbons worth of hair every day. I really don't think this is realistic, even for kids who are chewing their own hair. These levels are based on eating this every day long term. I know a lot of you probably hate maths, but it is where all the juicy stuff is when it comes to these topics. Also, this maximum allowable dose level is really low. They said it was the lowest in the US. If we go with Australian drinking water guidelines, the allowed level is actually 10 micrograms. You would need to eat 80 grams of the most leady hair a day to reach this level, so we're talking a bit more than 3 of these balls. If we go with the US FDA's level for children, which is actually lower than the Australian level, I know everyone keeps on going on about how dangerous US stuff is, but a lot of the time their limits are actually lower. You still need to eat the big half of a tennis ball of the worst hair to get to that. On the other hand, if we think about soil, I was actually at the bank in Leichhardt a few weeks back and a toddler was just eating the carpet, and looking at those numbers, you would only need to eat about 2 milligrams of dirt to reach the FDA allowable limit. If the dirt was meeting the safe Australian guideline, that is about 7 milligrams of dirt. Not to freak you out too much about dirt, these FDA levels do have big safety buffers, but in terms of lead exposure, a kid eating a tenth of a Tic Tac's worth of dirt is similar to eating half of this of the worst synthetic hair. So is this the dangerous lead thing that we should be focusing on? Then we have VOCs. These are like whiffy liquids that you might inhale, like solvents, petrol, alcohol. More of these evaporate with heat, and hair is sometimes heated during the braiding session. They have this chart. Basically, they are adding all the weights together. To get these numbers, they sealed the hair in a flask and they boiled it in water for 10 minutes. From what I've seen of dipping braids, it's maybe 10 or 15 seconds. VOCs are also gases, so ventilation makes a massive difference. Even without windows, air is leaky. I really don't love that they added all the VOCs together. They say the higher the total number of VOCs in a product, the higher the likelihood of a negative impact on the health of the user. I completely disagree with this because different VOCs have different effects. So for example, if you drink the same amount of ethanol, which is drinking alcohol, versus the same amount of methanol, which is wood alcohol, that's not the same risk. The wood alcohol will make you go blind. It is the same with inhaling different VOCs. The main one they measured in every sample was acetone. The acetone numbers are just much higher than everything else. A lot of this really big number just comes from acetone, which is actually a very safe substance. If you inhale a lot of acetone, then yes, it can be a respiratory irritant, but our bodies produce acetone. When we burn fat for energy, we breathe out some acetone, and it is also in nail polish remover. Only the ends of the hair get dipped, so worst case scenario, let's say half of the long braided hairstyle. That gives us 1.25 grams of acetone. This much nail polish remover, this is like a thumb tip amount if you're boiling the hair for 10 minutes. If all of this evaporates and you inhale it all at once, then that's not going to be that pleasant, but you would notice it before you have bad effects. It has a distinctive smell. I just don't think it's really realistic that that much acetone is actually evaporating when people are doing braids. If this much evaporated into a sealed box 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter, and then you were trapped inside that box breathing it for 8 hours, then you would hit Australia's safe work guideline. And the main issue there is still just irritation. So because acetone isn't all that concerning, I subtracted acetone from each of these and this is what we get. Hebigant and Darling are around the same now, but with the acetone, it looks like the Darling is like thousands of times worse, and now the worst product is actually one of the Shake and Go ones, which was in the top half before. I would say styrene is more concerning than acetone. But in these hair samples, it is all still really low. For styrene in the worst hair, the styrene would have to evaporate into a box not quite this big, and then you would have to huff that for 8 hours to reach the safe work limit. So at the very top of this article, it talks about the background. A student, Crystal Thomas, wrote a commentary paper about synthetic hair. She had braids done and her throat felt irritated. It smelled really strong, even after washing multiple times. Now, thinking back to the actual results from the Consumer Reports tests, extremely low amounts of benzene, methylene chloride, lead, styrene, and then slightly higher acetone, but really still not that much, not enough to have these sorts of effects for days. I think a more accurate way of framing the findings would be synthetic hair might be unsafe, but it isn't because of any of the carcinogens, heavy metals, or VOCs that we tested for. But that is a lot less exciting than this headline. At the bottom, they actually suggest some more likely culprits. So, for example, rashes and swelling could be allergens. My guess would be maybe acrylates. I've talked about acrylate allergies before. They're getting more common with people who are using home gel kits. Tight braids is a massive issue. It's painful on the scalp, so that could be confused with something from the hair, and it can cause hair loss. Other potential toxic chemicals in the hair, so synthetic hair doesn't really count as a cosmetic product. So there's rarely full ingredient lists. There is a lot less transparency. Again, I think it is cool that Consumer Reports are researching braiding hair, but the way they're presenting their findings are just kind of focusing on the not very scary shark. I saw some headlines around this saying black women deserve better, and I agree, but they don't just deserve better products and more research, they also deserve not to be misled by hyped up, questionable findings. Here is Consumer Reports' petition to the FDA. They say the FDA should look into hair, blah blah blah, especially known carcinogens such as benzene and heavy metals including lead. Your results show that benzene and lead aren't worth worrying about. And yes, in science, it is disappointing when the thing you thought was the issue turns out not to be after you put in a whole bunch of work, but that is still a useful result. That is a good thing you did, but now what you're doing here is not good. This is distracting everyone from looking for the bear. People are still having reactions to synthetic hair, or if we go even bigger picture, you should be petitioning your representatives to fund the FDA more, because currently, your regulators in the US are getting all their funding stripped. You are not going to have better regulation if we have all of this other crap happening. There are so many more impactful health things that the FDA regulates. Eating this much synthetic hair is just so ridiculously down the list, guys. Like, what are you doing? I haven't actually looked that deep into Consumer Reports before. It turns out they do a lot more reporting around food, and Food Science Babe, who is an excellent resource for these sorts of food science stories, she has an article about how they found heavy metals in chocolate. That is where I got those FDA guidelines from. It turns out Consumer Reports has a longer history of really exaggerating food risk, much like what they did here with hair. With beauty, back in December 2023, they posted about baby wipes in conjunction with a company called Made Safe. And this seems to be like an even crappier version of the EWG. If you look at their scientific advisors, we have multiple naturopaths, naturopathy is not science, there are a handful of natural remedies that work, but naturopathy promotes a whole bunch that do not work and are actually dangerous. It isn't like conventional medicine plus natural things, it is literally they do not learn or use actual science. More naturopaths in these links. We also have Mark Hyman, who is also a notoriously bad source for anything medicine or science. We have detox expert, homeopathic medicine, herbalist, wellness instructor. This is a very wild collection for your science advisory board, and it's no surprise that all of Consumer Reports' stuff with Made Safe are also just full of bad advice. Related to black women and hair, there was also a paper back in 2022 about how hair straightening products were linked to uterine cancer. I did a couple of Instagram posts on that, but I didn't do a proper video, so people keep asking me, so let's talk about it now. There's also a beauty psych on briefing note. The key points, the researchers estimated that for women who hadn't used straightening products in the past year, 1.6% would develop uterine cancer by age 70, but it was 4% for people who had used them more than 4 times that year. They found no increase for the other products, and they actually found a decrease for highlights. Now, even though this finding is double, the researchers highlight that the overall risk isn't big and uterine cancer is rare, the absolute difference just doesn't work out to be that big. They also highlight that there's lots of other factors linked to uterine cancer, and there are some potential issues with this study. Almost 1/3 of the subjects were excluded because they already had their uteruses removed, that is the main treatment for uterine cancer. Straightener users tended to be younger, premenopausal, and not on hormone therapy, so this could indicate that more non-users who already had uterine cancer weren't counted. If they were counted, that would even out the odds. The calculated risk also dropped massively for women who exercise more, which is weird, so this could signal that there's some unmeasured difference between people who do and don't use straighteners. So for example, black women who use straightening treatments, they might be more in situations where they're pressured to conform. So hair straighteners could be contributing to uterine cancer, but this study is just really not that conclusive. Again, what we need is more research, not hyping up the little findings we do have, because it makes the problem worse. If you enjoyed this, make sure you like and subscribe, follow me on everything. If you want more hair science, check out the playlist next to my head.